Hey, everybody, the world is a better place because you are here to join us. My name is Matt Brown, and I am the host of the Productive Conversations podcast. And it is Friday, a feel-good Friday, October 18th, 2024. I'm very excited for a very fun podcast that we're about to do as we do the tweet cap, and we're about to talk about what's trending in our world this past week. I have my compadres and compadras in Allison, Jose, and Ryan here. What's going on, everybody?
How's it going, Matt? How's it going, everybody?
How's it going?
Lots to do, lots to talk about. So let's get into it. Just a few reminders. Don't forget to like and subscribe to the Productive Conversations podcast on all podcasts and platforms and YouTube. And don't forget to check out exclusive content regarding this show across all social media platforms. We're on Instagram at Productive Conversations Podcast, exit Twitter at ProdCombopod. We're on TikTok at Productive Conversations and Facebook at Productive Conversations. And as always, we'll talk a little bit more in the middle of the show, but just want to thank our presenting sponsor, Magic Mind. This elixir is the thing that will enhance your life for the better. And as we'll give some more information later on in the show, just want to remind you that this shot, if you take it before your day begins, it will enhance your vitality. It will give you mental clarity. It will lessen your stress, and it will make you feel good. And go to magicmind.com/PCMB and use discount code PCMB20 for 48% of your first time purchase and 20% off your first, 48% of your first subscription and 20% off your first one-time purchase. So unique show, and as if you've been following me these past 2 weeks, pretty much a show every single day, this is our 13 done 13 shows in the last 14 days, and we've had quite a fun and busy October. So in this very unique situation, right? And as I told you first, number one, as we are following every single league championship series, ALCS and NLCS, we will have a reaction that is likely available by the time you're watching this show, but it will be available as soon as game three of the Yankees and Guardians is complete, and game four of the Mets and the Dodgers. So, yeah, lots going on. As I told you, this will be one unique day where both shows will be into one. Game three and four will be one podcast instead of two separate ones. And we'll have the great Alec Reeves with that one. As the time I'm recording this show, right now, the Yankees and the Guardians are tied at five at the top of the 10th inning. We will get my live reaction on that one, and then I'll obviously talk more about it on the separate podcast. And on top of that, we have the New York Mets and the LA Dodgers. And at this time, we have Tommy Edman hitting a ball in the gap, and now the Dodgers have taken a 2-1 lead in the top of the third inning, Dodgers and Mets. And again, we will talk about all of that going on. So you will see my reactions. I know Allison's into it. Jose and Ryan are into it as well. And so if there's a little discombobulation, that's it. Because obviously this is a very special month. But a special time. So if you see random outbursts, if you've been seeing anyways in this month, that's exactly what it is. But besides that, the show will go on, and we will talk about what's trending. So first things with what's trending, right? Why don't we talk about a living legend in the world of Hollywood? We have Al Pacino, right? We talked, looks like months ago, about how Al Pacino became a father once again at the age of 84. Now, Al Pacino actually just recently released a memoir, and he's doing a press tour, and he was recently asked about what's it like being a new father at 84 years old, a time when people usually become great-grandfathers or grandfathers, but he becomes a dad, and, you know, I guess you are a special person in that way. I mean, anyways, so Al Pacino said this regarding an update with his son. He says here, he texts me from time to time. I want to be around for this child. I hope I am. I hope I stay healthy, and he knows who his dad is, of course. And by the way, there's more to that quote. when asked about living with him, he does not live with his son. New son. He lives with his baby mama, who is the same age, who's just a little bit older than me and Ryan and Allison. And currently dating Bill Maher.
Jose. That's right.
And yeah, this is weird. Am I right? And Kike Hernandez has singled to short, hits a single to the shortstop. Now 3-1, Los Angeles. But yeah, so Al Pacino. It's hard. I don't want to say he's an absentee father, but I mean, this is a weird situation, right? I'm trying my best not to judge. I really am. But especially, I mean, Al Pacino is literally gold. He's Hollywood gold. He's an American icon. What? 5-decade-long career, and he's literally as good as it gets, becoming both a genuine movie star and an actor's actor. But I mean, that those are some weird quotes to see.
Well, yeah, and that quote wasn't even, well, not that it wasn't full or whatever, but it lacks the very important context that this child is 16 months old.
Yeah.
So obviously he's not texting his kid. His kid is like 1.5. So
he's Goo Goo Gaga.
Right, yeah. Well, I mean, he's clearly texting the child's mother, which, good. You should do that. Make sure everything's okay, right? But at the same time, that means that he isn't seeing his kid because he doesn't live with them and he doesn't see him. They just text. You know what I mean? And so to me, that indicates kind of being absentee.
I mean, technically by the definition of the word, that is an absentee father. And just one second.
Very still.
So anyways, but yeah. Awkward, right?
It is. And this is the same with De Niro, right? He's got the kid. He's not 84, but he's old. And I guess
I think he's 83.
Yeah. Well, I thought he was just 80, actually.
Oh, maybe.
But like, obviously, they have the means to like financially support a kid, and I guess that has to be enough. But like, it is admirable for him to be like, I want to be there for the kid. I hope I can be. But like, you can be now, dude.
You're Al Pacino.
Like, you're alive at the moment. You know, you could do it now. You don't have to hope that in a little bit. But I mean, it's clear that he just wants to get the baby thing out of the way. He doesn't want to do the baby thing. You know what I mean? And then once it's older, he's totally down to hang out with it once it can like walk itself and use the bathroom itself and all that stuff. But also these women who let Robert De Niro and Al Pacino have a child with them, God bless, I guess. I don't know what to say.
I mean, this is exactly what we were talking about.
Allison,
when this
would you
broke.
Let Al Pacino?
Absolutely not.
Okay. I didn't think so.
I don't think I'd let any 84-year-old man near me. Unless it's like my grandpa.
Well, yeah, but and certainly not, you know.
Yeah, no intimate moments.
Yeah, and if it is, and
oh,
if you do get,
not.
And if you do get intimate, you're certainly not gonna allow procreation to happen, right?
No,
that's why it's better for her to be with somebody closer to her age. The 68-year-old Bill Maher. Jose, still waiting for you. Yeah, unless you have accepted that she's now dating him and not tapping that ass.
He's just tapping it. When's the last time you seen a photo of them dating?
Yes,
like last week. It was Ryan last week. Yesterday.
Where was this yesterday?
On Twitter. It's all on Twitter. Everything's on Twitter.
My God. Just because they post a photo from like weeks ago and post it yesterday and be like, it just happened.
I want to ask something before we move on from the segment, though. Is it at all possible, we think, that it's not Al Pacino's kid and it's not Robert De Niro's kid? Is it possible
Billy Crystal's kid?
No, I'm saying, is it possible these like ladies have like younger men that they're also with? Because so, and I say that because yes, theoretically, a man of any age can have a kid. Theoretically. But it is significantly
Yankees lose.
No, Yankees didn't do something
due to
well,
a David Fry home run to right. I will talk about that. Remember, available instant reaction to game four.
To the games.
So to game three of the ALCS. Sorry to interrupt you, Ryan.
No, it's okay.
That is a problem because they should not have blown this game. That was a great game, but bad loss. We'll talk about that with Alec. Again, we'll talk about that with Alec on an episode that is, like I said, is probably available at this time. Sorry, yes. Again, Yankees lose 7-5 in game 3. Yankees still up 2-1. Game 4 will be tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Okay.
My point was just that it's hard to have a kid at 84 years old, even if you're a guy. It's impossible if you're not a guy. It's possible for a woman, but it's still difficult for a guy. So I feel like it has to be explored, the idea. I'm sure that they probably did a paternity test, and I'm just being silly. But it's very possible in my mind, anyway, if they didn't do a paternity test, that the kids are not even theirs. But that's a different story for a different time with some evidence. I don't want to posit too wildly. I just wanted to throw that out as a conspiracy theory that I would very much believe. And I don't love conspiracy theories.
I do love conspiracy theories, but we'll worry about that another day. But why don't we go from 84-year-olds to 82-year-olds? So
that's right.
We have the owner of the Dallas Cowboys, Jerry Jones. He's owned it for multiple decades. NFL Hall of Famer, genuinely a big deal and a legend in the NFL, even if he does drive people crazy sometimes. Now, so far, the Dallas Cowboys are 3-3. However, they have not won a game at home, and they've been blown out twice at home now. And a big blowout, losing by a score of 47-9 on Jerry Jones's 82nd birthday. And now people really are in the right to question what's going on. Despite re-signing CeeDee Lamb and Dak Prescott, they did not make many moves this offseason to improve either their offense or defense. Even though right now the NFC East is wide open, there is plenty of concerns for the Cowboys right now, especially defensively. Now, amongst that, Jerry Jones goes on a weekly radio spot in the Dallas area, 105.3 The Fan in Dallas. And when being questioned about why, you know, what's going on this season, things are looking really bad, things are crashing out on the team. Well, he did not appreciate it. Though this is long, a bit long, it's about 2 minutes. Here's some of the snippets of Jerry Jones not appreciating being questioned about the Dallas Cowboys right now.
Seems like my point?
Listen, let me tell you what I'll do. Let me tell you what I'll do about it. I will let us sit down and look at the decisions we've made over the last several years. Okay? I'll look at it. Now, if you think I'm interested in on a damn phone call with you over a radio and sitting here and throwing all the good out with the dishwater, you have got to be smoking something over there this morning. I'm not. And I really don't, and I don't even want our listeners to listen to me, to talk about this is not your job. Your job isn't to let me go over all the reasons that I did something and I'm sorry that I did it. That's not your job.
Well, my job is to ask
get
why.
A job, or I'll get somebody else to ask these questions, man.
Jerry, we're trying to figure out why
I'm not kidding you. You're not going to figure out what the team is doing right or wrong. If you are, or any 5 or 10 like you, you need to come to this meeting I'm going to today. There are 32 teams here. You're geniuses.
Jerry,
okay? Y'all really think you're going to sit here with a microphone and tell me all of the things that I've done wrong and without going over the rights?
What?
Now, listen, we both know we're talking to a lot of great fans and a lot of great listeners, and I am very sorry for what happened out there Sunday. I'm sick about what happened Sunday. Now, I'm not talking to these yahoos on the end of this phone. I'm talking to you, the fans that are listening this morning. And we can spend a lot of time going over zigging and zagging. One of the stupidest things I've ever done. that anybody has ever analyzed is by the Cowboys. It was an idiot that did that. So idiot things can turn into good decisions. Okay? Smart things can turn into bad decisions. The facts are that when you make one, you don't really know whether it's going to be good or not at the time. So let's just go ahead. I'm trying to answer your questions, man.
All right. I have to say,
the stupidest thing I've done was buy the Cowboys.
I have to say,
what kind of defense is that?
Like I said, he's a very old, passionate man, and I honestly hope I have as much wit and swagger that he has. Even though I don't hate the Cowboys right now, I much hate the Eagles a lot more as a Giants fan. I do respect Jerry Jones, and he's really been funny over the last few years. But, I mean, yeah, the Cowboys haven't won a Super Bowl, even been in a Super Bowl, not even been in the NFC Championship in 30 years next year. And, yeah, this guy's going crazy, simply. He literally can't take anymore. He spent so much money. On top of being the owner, he's also the GM. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, he's clearly had enough. And he just wants to finally win. I mean, obviously, I don't want to see that shit, but Dallas is America's team, unfortunately, and they do have this big fan base across the nation, and yeah, he's got to hold himself accountable. But also, I commend the radio hosts for doing their job, and I've seen a lot of people in the media sticking by them as well, because they have to ask him these tough questions. And ultimately, again, I just think it's a grumpy old man, for lack of a better term, but shoot, this guy's going to go nuts at 82 years old, if not already.
I would say, for me anyway, like, I kind of see both sides of it, and that's such a lame answer. So he's right.
He's right. All right, right.
Yeah, he is right about the fact that if they were, you know, savants who could do that, right, could turn the team around and win the Super Bowl, then they'd be in the room with all the other savants, right, doing that. Like, that's what they would be doing. They wouldn't be sitting behind the mic talking. However, it is their job to ask why the team's not winning. And as the GM, it is his job to answer, and also, at least partially, his responsibility for why they're not winning, right? So, mm-hmm. Like, I get it. And what I think he was trying to say is, like, you guys couldn't do better. And that's probably true. But that doesn't mean they're not doing their job. They are. Like you said, they can't do that job better than you, so they're not trying. They're doing their job, which is to ask the people who own the team and run the team why the team that they, you know, that they're affiliated with can't win any games. I mean, and honestly, if he wasn't an owner, by the way, if he was just a regular GM, this, like, I mean, like, and this would not have been, no one would be siding with him. There would have been there would have been no deference to him either. Like, again, they were very deferential, and they tried to, like, assuage his ego with that, because he's the owner of the team as well as, you know, the manager. But, like, if it was a normal person who was hired to manage that team, people would be calling for them to go. 30 years? You can't yeah. win after 30 years? You got the biggest stadium. You got all the money in the world. You're probably the best known team, football team, sorry, on the planet. Like, I would say that people in other countries know the Dallas Cowboys are NFL football. You know what I mean? Like, your brand is synonymous with the sport, and you haven't been to the NFC title game in 30 years? That's anyone right. else, they would be on their fourth GM right now if the GM hadn't been the guy who bought the team. So I feel like it was totally fair to ask. I understand what his point was, and that they can't do better, and he's probably correct in that, but that doesn't mean they weren't doing their job. They were. You're just mad because they're doing their job and you, Jerry, are not.
Nothing beats the I'll get somebody else to do it.
Well, yeah, they don't work for you, bud. Who are you gonna fire? They don't even work for you.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. That's I don't think they own this radio station. So
WFAN, no way.
Yeah,
no, but he's contracted though.
What does that mean? He can't fire them. He could stop
fire them, but he can stop going. That's the name.
Okay.
He's his number one program.
Whatever will
they do? Get someone else?
They'll just talk anyway. They don't need him there. Him being there is actually a gift to him. Because if he wasn't there, they would have sat there the whole time, just the three of them, talking to all those same people about how absolutely terrible the Cowboys looked in their last game. He admitted it, by the way. The fact that he was there, honestly, that's good PR. And you know what? We talk about I talk about my boy Aaron Rodgers on the Jets. Why do you think that Pat McAfee show is still happening? Because they're not doing good. And that he can spin the entire season every Tuesday on the McAfee show to like millions of people. And that way he can still be the best quarterback ever, even though the team can't score more than what? A touchdown a game and a couple of freaking kicks? He threw the game losing interception 2 weeks in a row.
By the way, I saw that it was the highest rated McAfee show on Tuesday ever.
I'm sure
it was very interesting.
But like I said, the point is, when someone hands you a microphone after you've done a really bad job, maybe you don't look that gift horse in the mouth and you use that microphone to try and convince some people that you'll do better next time, because Jerry Jones didn't do that like at all. It didn't sound like anything was going to change other than he might stop going on a morning radio show, and that's not going to make the team better.
Nope. It's very funny. They're off this week, but clearly something's got to give. And also Mike McCarthy's on the hot seat more than ever likely.
He's not on a hot seat. They're going to keep him through the whole season.
Yeah, no, they're going to fire him. They're going to fire him at the end of the year if they don't make
it. What's his contract?
This is the last year of his contract. They're not going to resign.
Well, they're not going to fire him. They're going to let him go, but they're not firing him.
Well, I don't know. You saw how that's angry this. You saw what Woody Johnson did. You saw how disgruntled this guy is.
But what's the name? Never fire someone in the offseason. He always lets them go when the contract is done.
Yeah,
that's I know. But then now he's 82. He's 82 years old and angry, and really rich.
Well,
you definitely make a good point, and you're not wrong. But I think I wouldn't be surprised is what I'm saying.
But who are they gonna get?
Well, they'll do the interim, and then they'll go for Robert Bill Belichick.
I heard he's free.
I really think he'll give Bill Belichick the realm, and he'll give up his GM role for Bill, because he was also the GM for the Pats as well, and give him everything before he dies.
That's not happening.
Well, we'll see. This guy wants to win.
Yeah, but he wants to win as the GM. That's the catch. Mm-hmm. He wants to win. He doesn't want to own the winning team.
Yes,
he wants to win.
He wants to be the reason why they won. That's exactly. Why he let go Jimmy Johnson.
Exactly.
Fair enough. Good points. I'm just going to take the other way with that. So I respect either side, both sides. Okay. I have this clip. So also, again, unique. I write an agenda like most producers, right? I didn't have time with a busy day today to fully write these. I had my notes. I just never made it into an agenda, except for the important stuff. So we're going to do a lot of improvising. I play in these segments anyways, but they're just not in a particular order, except the biggest stories and then the final one. So this one, it's called For Allison.
Oh.
Look at this. From SELSELSREP. First, what is this a reaction to? First is this. Did you guys know that this is Hollywood's newest couple? This is adorable. Martin Short and Meryl Streep. How about that? Isn't that adorable?
I did. They actually played a couple on a show, and then they became a couple after that.
That has my approval. This is the Travis and Taylor for people 50 and older.
God.
But this is what I saw for Allison. Can't believe this is what Selena and Taylor were gossiping about this whole time. First of all, do you know, is this an iconic photo?
Yeah.
I don't know the photo.
Oh.
So there was like a situation at the awards show where she wanted a photo, but was it Kendall Jenner's? Like, it was her boyfriend or something, and Selena asked for a photo, and they said no. It was like this whole thing. It was like unnecessary drama.
So it wasn't about Martin Short and Meryl Streep.
No.
Photos old as hell.
The photos when we were in like elementary school.
Is it? I just saw this
that's
today.
An old photo.
Oh,
super old.
And she wrote, "No, I told Taylor about two of my friends who hooked up. Not that that's anyone's business, but it must be her co-stars from what's the show called on Hulu?
Only Murders in the Building."
Yep. So it clearly was that.
Is it? It's a marketing little joke there, because so the show that they worked on together, Matt, was that one. Meryl Streep joined the cast last season.
Yeah, I just haven't gotten to it, but I very much
fun show. I like it. It's a good show.
I'm definitely in awe of the cast. I just haven't gotten to it yet.
It's a good show. Fun show.
So now, look at this. Love is in the air.
Love is in the air. Al Pacino Al Pacino has a new kid. Martin Short has a new girl. Meryl Streep has a new guy. Love is in the air.
I believe this is probably the best Hollywood couple out there, more than Taylor and Travis. Yeah, by the way,
that's what he wants you to hear, Allison. Allison, do you agree? Which is better, Taylor, Travis, or Meryl and Martin?
Taylor.
They both have the alliteration too. It's like
Taylor and Travis. Stupid. Sorry, the Mets ground out in a double play to end the third inning, and they had bases loaded. Sorry. Keep going. But
no,
yes,
I was asking
Travis and Taylor.
Yeah, they both have alliteration. They're both very famous. Are you sure that you think Travis and Taylor is better? And if so, why?
You know, Taylor's my girl. I'm picking her number.
But besides blind loyalty, we don't reward blind loyalty on this show.
What?
No, we want facts and figures. This is hard hitting news.
This is hard hitting news.
This is what the people come
for. Are they really dating, or were they just seen together?
No, they are really dating. They've been dating for a while. Yes.
Yeah, see, because we have 100%, nobody wants to believe anybody's relationship in a celebrity on this show.
That's true. That's true. I've noticed that. Everyone but the fans just assume, like, so yeah, you're a big fan of Taylor and Travis, so you think it's love at first sight, they're gonna get married. And then everybody else is in a relationship, that's make believe. Whereas Matt doesn't like Taylor and Travis, so they're make believe. But he likes Martin and Meryl, so that's for real. Everybody is just we talk about love being in the air, maybe in Hollywood, but down here with the rest of us, love is not in the air. But whatever is in the air, it stinks. Okay, we have to get happy. We have to be happier.
Well, at least they're both rich.
Well, I mean, listen, everything is better when you're rich, right? Like, we could just say that. I think Jose, do you agree with that?
I gotta go for an 84.
No, you think that it's not better to be rich?
It's better to be poor.
What happened to homeboy yesterday? What's his name? He's saying more money, more problems.
Liam Payne. Boy, this is a bad segue to say rest in peace, but
yeah.
Well, I'm very sorry that happened. But anyways, keep going, Ryan. Save the day.
Yeah, I was just going to say, we won't even touch that. Obviously, you know, thoughts and prayers to everybody who had to deal with that and to his family and friends. But by and large, money is nice to have. So I agree, Allison, but it's like, since they're both rich, you know what I mean? You have to, everyone, all four are rich. So the richness doesn't matter. It's about true love. And can you really know true love at such a young age, I wonder?
By the way, the call was overturned. Brandon Nimmo beats it out. It's now 3-2 at LA.
Look at you. Overreacting.
Hey, the guy called him out.
It just changed on my screen too, and I'm watching the play by play. But yeah, no, that's what I think. That's what I think. I say good for them. I won't lie. I wasn't certain that Martin Short liked women. I know that he's dated women.
I didn't think he did, but.
But yeah, but you know what makes him? He's a good actor, right? Convinced me, and so there you go.
There you go, indeed. Why don't we have a moment here to show you Big Daddy Mark's newest viral song? Do you want to guess what his big viral song is? If you, please,
I'm not gonna guess.
Was it the one I sent you?
Maybe.
I won't guess. Oh. I just want to say that I've heard now dozens of people who have heard the Mo Bamba version. And I tell every single one of them that we were on top of this first, and yes, we were. And honestly, big man, if you get this, if you hear this, you're about to blow up. We know that. You have to remember who were the first people who sat here. We listened to like literally like 10 minutes of your stuff on this show. We had a whole two segments dedicated to us laughing and listening at some of the greatest content in music and comedy. So, you know, just saying. At T Tweet Cap, at Proud Pod, you know. Let us know if you're free for a collaboration. That's all I'm saying. Amen. I'll sing the low part. You know what I mean?
Didn't his album drop?
His album did drop. And we promoted that album. Every single sale of that album could have been us. All of the sales could have been us. And again, I'll do the low part. I used to sing in high school. All right? Yeah, I did musicals and everything.
You were in band?
Whole nine yards. I was in band. Yep.
Wow.
Did some singing in college as well. I'll do the low parts there. You take that high. You got the high register on lockdown. Yes, you got the high register on lockdown. I'll take it low. I'll do just a, you know, baseline. Give you something a little extra on your next video. Let's see how it goes.
Mm-hmm. All right. So here is Big Daddy Mark's next big hit. All right. 1 second. Ready? Here Ready. We go.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Wake up! Grab a bunch of pillow, little makeup!
Yeah.
I just got a day with a chicka! Why'd you leave the kids up on the demo? Here you go, creating on the bimbo! You wanted to! Grab a bunch of pillow, little makeup! You wanted to! I just got a day with a chicka! You wanted to! Why'd you leave the kids up on the demo? I don't think you trust in my self-righteous suicide. I cry when angels deserve to die. Wake up! Got a bunch of put a little makeup. How's it gonna fit it when it shake up? Why you let the kid up on the table? And you got queen on a bimbo. You wanted to grab a bunch of put a little makeup. You wanted to. I just got the video when it shook up. You wanted to. Why you let the kids up on the table? I don't think you trust in my self-righteous suicide. I cry when angels deserve to die.
Chop suey, system of a down.
But listen to that song. All he needed was one more person to hit that second you wanted to. I'm here.
I really like the end of that song.
I'm here,
song.
Mark. I mean, yeah. I've never heard that much vibrato thrown on that song before. And that was kind of interesting to listen to.
you know what?
He's like, I want one more.
Just do it
every
just
time.
Cause.
Every time.
How about Kane's theme?
Oh.
My God, that's it's Kane. That's gotta be Kane.
We're gonna use this version for Mayor Jacobs' next campaign rally.
Do they really use it?
No, God.
Oh. Knoxville County, Tennessee.
That's right.
Okay, I forgot how long it takes till the.
I know. He waits. He doesn't start later. That's not how it goes. The song starts when it starts.
The wonder of the world is gone. I know for sure. All the wonder that I want, I found it hurt. As the whole becomes a part, I try to burn. And no flame returns.
What's taking so long for WWE to put him on?
Jesus.
Oh.
That would be an absolute nightmare. What is he going to sing? Kingdom? What if he sings Kingdom?
I got the looks.
Oh, I could do this one.
I think I'm cute.
I know I'm sexy. I got the looks that drive the girls wild. I got the moves that really move them. I sent chills up and down their spines. I'm just a sexy boy. Sexy boy. I'm not your boy toy. Boy toy. I'm just a sexy boy. Sexy boy. I'm not your boy toy. Boy toy.
I think he hit it.
I'll say, now that you've said that, if he does do Sean's entrance in NXT for something, I'd be fine with that. He could be assistant GM for the day.
Hey, quickly, right? I saw this great clip, and the clip is titled "Gen Z Always Got Something to Say." And as I play you this, I was thinking, man, is this an ultimate Gen Z video? Why don't we play that for you really quickly? Swoop.
Percy, I just don't understand why it took you so long to get ready in the morning, man. When I was young, when I was your age, I used to be ready and at the door and walking out the door. I had to walk 4 or 5 miles to school. See, my mama wouldn't have dealt with this, dog. Y'all soft these days.
You had to walk to school?
Yeah, I had to walk to school.
You had to walk to school when grandma had a car at home?
Yeah, but the whole point was that I walked to school and my mama went ahead. And when I was little, she would say, get out of this house. You ain't going to sit and play this game all day. Go outside and go play.
And when did she make you go outside?
Like 8, 9 a.m.
And when did you come back?
About 6, 7 o'clock at
so
night.
She had you outside all day?
She told me to go play all
that
day.
That sounds very responsible. Like, you could have been dehydrated. You could have been dying. You could have been starving. Who knows?
Point I'm making is, you be talking to daddy, I'm thirsty. You want to come in the house and get a drink? I usually drink out the water hose. That's why I'm tougher.
So, outside, you had there was water in your house, and you decided to drink out of the water hose.
Yeah,
grandma made you drink out of a water hose when they had perfectly fine water inside.
What are you trying to say?
That sounds pretty irresponsible. It just sounds like you're just a good dad, and grandma was just being irresponsible. I don't know.
I ain't never think of it that way. My mama was a good mama. The point, go. Walk to the car. You talk too much, anyways. See, Google. That's the problem right now. I would have never been able to say this to my mama. Correcting my mama.
Google, that's the problem right now.
Is he spot on or what?
Jose, what do you think?
Yep.
What do you mean, yep, he's spot on or what?
He's spot on. He's right. Though it's father anyway.
That's what's all right, yeah. Obviously we were talking about the father. That's the main.
Yeah,
well, I don't know. Right.
Everything says.
I mean, a lot of bad things happened back in the day to kids. Less so than now. Or more so than now. I think there's a happy middle ground. Right?
No.
What do you mean no? You have to drink. I mean, listen, not the saying I didn't drink out of the hose, but I'm just saying, like, you gotta drink out of the hose water?
That's what we used to do as kids.
It's what I did too, but I'm just
water
saying.
Always tasted better anyways.
Yeah, they had a taste. It's probably some metallic stuff that we did.
Yeah, we all had a disease, probably.
But fuck it was good.
No, I'm saying this as someone who did that. So, like, I'm not even sitting here trying to be like, no, it's been like, no, I did this. I'm just saying, realistically, especially like when our parents were kids, you know what I mean? And I get that this guy is probably actually closer to like Jose's age than like my parents, but even still, like, there was definitely things that could have been improved upon. If you look at the world and what happened to kids and how kids were back in those times, I feel like you can be honest and say, yeah, maybe that wasn't a great style of parenting, or you know what I mean, like, maybe that could have gone a little differently.
And people, these kids these days, these little ass kids are a bunch of pussies, no offense. Like, well,
who,
I used
who are
to
you
walk.
Offending? I'm a grown
I,
man, so I don't have to make fun of children. But
the listeners.
I used to walk back in the day, like a mile to get to my bus stop.
Mm.
And these motherfuckers came walk down the street.
I didn't have to walk a mile. I did walk down the street when I took the bus.
Or we had bicycles. We didn't stay on our phones. These little kids don't know what they don't understand what they got.
We put the playing cards into the spokes to make it sound like a motorcycle.
Yep. Yeah,
no, we did that. That's what I mean. I'm with you. I'm with the people here. I'm just saying, realistically, you know, like, some of it could have been, you know, better. I don't think that. I think maybe we've overcorrected. Maybe. But I do think that there are some things that parenting-wise in general, throughout time, like parents make mistakes because they don't know something. And then when they learn something, they correct it and start doing something different, you know? So, but that kid, I will say, like, I feel like he could have been less like grandma was a bad grandma, a bad mom, and more like, well, times were different. You know what I mean? Like, he could have said that better. Be like, times were different when you were a kid. Times were harder, perhaps. Now we live in the modern day. And I feel like that would have been the same point, but less mean to his grandmother, you know?
Funny stuff. So in the news also, right? We had the grocery store chain known as Kroeger upset a lot of people out there. I believe there's a Kroeger in Bridgeport, the one in Connecticut. Is there one by you, Ryan?
No, Kroeger is not that big down here. There was one near my school in Rochester.
See, yeah. Well, yeah, like I said, there's one in Bridgeport. Allison, was there one in the plains of Wisconsin?
No, but I think the closest one was Ohio.
Did you guys have the Piggly Wiggly instead?
We did. I actually have a Piggly Wiggly shirt. My mom spent like a certain amount on groceries, mm-hmm. so they gave away a shirt, and it's Green Bay Packer color, so it's green and the writing's yellow, and it has the pig on the front. It says Piggly Wiggly, and then it has a pig butt on the back, and that says Shop the Pig.
I never heard of that.
Go Pack Go. Does it say that anywhere?
No.
Jose.
as soon as I said, for people, like, obviously you all heard, but as soon as I said Piggly Wiggly, the Wisconsin rose up.
I was so
it's literally called Piggly Wiggly.
That is the name of the store. Piggly Wiggly.
So like we have Stu Leonard's
here. Pig line is Shop the Pig and Save.
So like there's a Whole Foods, there's a Kroger, there's a Publix, Stu Leonard's for if you are in Norwalk, there's a Wegmans, there's a pig, it's literally called Piggly Wiggly.
Piggly Wiggly, yep.
Yeah, Piggly Wiggly.
You could go to Stop and Shop or Piggly Wiggly. That's you get to choose.
I'm gonna find that shirt. Because I feel like Matt doesn't believe me.
I believe you. It's just a funny name.
It is a very funny name. That's why I brought it up.
But for this grocery store, the Kroger, Ryan, you brought this to all of our attentions.
Mm-hmm.
But tell us, what the hell did this Kroger do?
So Kroger, by the way, the largest supermarket chain in the U.S., according to Newsweek. So,
really?
Yeah, apparently they're big. Bigger than I know. Like, they're not
down
here.
You heard of Kroger, Jose?
No. Well, yeah, I heard of it, but never been to one.
I think it's bigger, like Allison's saying, like Ohio, Michigan. I am surprised there's none in Wisconsin, to be honest with you, because it feels like that's a place. Or I don't know if there is none, but you just said that you didn't know of one. So, but anyway, so the biggest supermarket chain, apparently, and it's fallen into a congressional investigation for its use of facial recognition technology and electronic, I want to say, let me make sure I have the right thing. Yes, electronic shelving labels. And the problem, or what they're saying the problem is that Kroger was able to use that, or was trying to use that technology for surge pricing. So for those of you who don't know what surge pricing is, you know how when you're going to the bar in your Uber and it's like $10 because it's just down the road, but then it's 2 a.m, you can't really walk, you call the Uber, that same trip back, it's $100. That's surge pricing, because everybody and their mother just called an Uber to that same spot. Everyone's paying more because people that Uber knows people will pay for it. So they're saying that Kroger is attempting to do the same thing with prices. And that's why they installed these electronic shelving labels, so they can change the price in real time on produce, on other products, on any of the goods you'd buy in the store. So you could walk into the store and the bacon could cost whatever. I think bacon at this point is like 8-something, 9-something, depending on if you get the store brand, right? But if everyone is buying bacon because you're all, you know, it's about to be like Christmas dinner or Christmas morning and you're all got bacon and you're shopping, they could jack the price up and everybody's not paying $14 because they know people will pay because they know people need bacon. And so, again, you put that at a time like now where grocery prices are so high, that's going to make a lot of people mad. So yeah, they're under investigation. They say that they weren't ever going to do that. It was just a pilot program, but that's where they stand right now. And I want to go on record saying, just change the labels manually. Just, have someone come in. It's another job, right? Someone just comes in, says, all right, here's what the price is for the day, puts it on there, and then that's that. And then the next day, if it changes, you change it the next day. But having someone be able to just walk into an office, flip a switch, press a button, whatever, and everything jumps up, 6%, 8%, I don't know. I don't feel good about that. How does everybody else feel, though?
Well, why is there a program?
That pisses me off. I was very annoyed and upset when you showed this. Like, they really want us to self-destruct and turn it to the robots for Elon. Like, come on. Is this necessary, really?
Right. I mean, who thought surge pricing for groceries was a good idea? All right. When Wendy's tried to do this, remember Wendy's tried to do this with fast food, not groceries, fast food. And the pushback was so great that they discontinued the program.
The internet,
because people got
it.
So mad. And by the way, what Wendy's was trying to say, like the thing that they were saying was like, oh, it could lower the prices, right? And everyone read through that nonsense. So like, there is no way that food should be contingent upon how hungry you are. If you're hungry, you pay more. That's ridiculous. Food.
Come on. That's some bullshit. It really is.
It really is.
That's like, not to get too political on this, but either side, whether you're a Republican, a Democrat, Fonzarelli, what was that Fonzie thing? If you're Family Guy,
the birthday party,
Kanye the birthday West. Party. Oh, god, the red's too damn high party. But the point is, like, this is exactly what you're supposed to fight and help to prevent. Oh, care about the Americans and the middle class and the lower class and the working class and try to stop them. You were just supposed to prevent clown tactics like this one. And yeah, thank goodness for that senator you showed in the open letter to stop it, doing what they want. I might get my own address to support them. Now, that's what we're talking about. That, yes. Those are great politicians there. But for the other hundreds of them staying quiet, shame on you for that. Upsetting is a thing, but I
hope in case you wanted to know, Matt, for the shout out, it was Congresswoman Rashida Tlaib of Michigan, Senator Elizabeth Warren of Massachusetts, and Senator Bob Casey of Pennsylvania. Those are the three that led this original effort into the investigation, and we'll see what happens from there.
Indeed, indeed. And also, Mookie Betts with a double in the gap as well, 5-2. Los Angeles. But yep, upsetting. But like you said, Ryan, not every idea is a good idea.
I mean, yes, exactly. And we've been covering, obviously, the internet for a very long time. 422 episodes, 22 of them in like the last 3 weeks. And listen, I mean this sincerely, for the good folks over at Kroeger, it might be the worst idea I've ever heard. Nobody wants to pay more for groceries, especially not because the store is busy. Like, just like Jose would say, sell the food, keep it moving.
Mm-hmm. Yes, keep it moving indeed. And however, if you are looking for a good idea, if you are looking for a good idea, not a bad idea, one good idea that you should definitely try is the idea that is given from our amazing friends at Magic Mind. You have to try Magic Mind. That is one amazing idea we have. And anybody can have it. And like I've said before, and so has Ryan, we could not be here today without maintaining our focus and energy. And how do we get that? It's from Magic Mind, and Magic Mind supporting us as well. Our team loves Magic Mind because we know firsthand that this is a fantastic product that makes a genuine difference in the way you feel over time. I promise you that this really does work as advertised. It is simple as well. You add Magic Mind to your morning routine, and it could be before the gym, it could be on your way to the train, the bus, your car, if you want to walk, you want to go on a bicycle, if you want to fly, any of that. You take your Magic Mind before your day begins. And if you do that, you will notice the natural boost in your energy, and these effects do last. And it's not a quick shot for a short boost and an eventual crash. No, it's not. It's an actual supplement to help you feel more energetic and focused each and every day. Since I started taking Magic Mind, it genuinely is easier for me to wake up in the morning, and I have a lot more focus throughout my week. And I mean this, and I genuinely mean this. I can't even hit the snooze button anymore. I get up rested, refreshed, and ready to go. And as we said, in this very busy month of October, I've had the energy to do all these shows because of this incredible product that I have right here in Magic Mind. And unlike our mid Krabby Patties that we had earlier this week, check out the clip on all social media platforms. Magic Mind tastes good, and it's full of vitamins and their signature nootropics to fight back against fatigue by giving you longer-lasting energy, that all-important mental clarity, and most of all, just a good positive mindset for the day. I can't recommend this stuff enough. For members of the Productive Nation who are interested in this, go check out the Magic Mind website, and I promise you, you won't regret it. Also, the Magic Mind team has graciously given us a special offer we can share with all of our amazing fans. Right now, you can get 48% off your first subscription by using discount code PCMB20, or get 20% off a one-time purchase using the same discount code PCMB20. Head on over to MagicMind.com/PCMB, and if you're interested in Magic Mind, use discount code PCMB20 to get a great deal on an excellent product. And we have the link and code in the description below, so check that out on all podcasting platforms and YouTube. Our friends at Magic Mind can only give us a deal like this for a limited time, so be sure to order as soon as you can and take advantage of this opportunity. All right, let's move on to some other things. There's been one question. I don't know if you're familiar with the account. At Greg 1667-693-5420.
I am.
Well, he asked a question that has been going viral, and forgive me if you're a little queasy with this, but I'll say it anyways because we're all human. I'm going to show you the question that made it to Stephen A. Not interested in what Stephen A has to say. I'm interested in what Allison, Ryan, and Jose have to say. So here's a question from Greg.
At Greg 1667-693-5420. Stephen A. Smith, if you're at a friend's house and clog the toilet and there's no plunger, what do you do?
You tell me. Who wants to go first?
I want to first say, I don't want to go first. I want someone else to answer first, but I want to add some context here, or not context, but something important. There was a difficult time. He actually said... Yeah, at one point he tweeted, "At Stephen A, please help. I can't stay in here forever." But anyway, Pat McAfee's show answered this question as well. They saw it go viral, and so they also answered Greg. But anyway, Allison, Jose, one of you, tell me, what do you do if you're in that situation? I want to know.
Tell the friend.
What do you tell him? Just like, hey, this happened. Hey, like, yeah, what do you do?
I mean, if you're good friends, like, hey, dude, I just clogged your toilet. Like, I don't know. I would tell them.
And that's that. But you tell them and you're done. You wash your hands of the situation at that point.
I mean, probably
no pun intended.
Something. Probably figure something out. Like, I don't know. Whatever's in the house, figure it out.
Has this ever happened to either of you?
No, thank God.
I think actually it happened to me in elementary school. Now that we're
come on, Larry.
Elementary school. I feel like that's.
I told my friend because there wasn't a plunger,
mm-hmm.
and it was at her dad's house, so the dad had to come in and he helped out.
Oh no!
But there was a plunger upstairs, so they ended up finding one, so it was fine. But
that's tough. They'd be plunger, dad right there.
There was a plunger somewhere. So you know, it is what
there
it is. Go.
Yeah, that's what it is, exactly. Jose, what about you? What is your advice to Greg?
Just come out clean. Just say you clogged the toilet. Had a lot of fiber today. Call it a day.
How about you say your toilet's broken and it wasn't my fault?
Oh, definitely. Oh. In the toilet. They're gonna know.
Pretend say you should. You say you should. You should have cleaned it. It's on you.
Have you seen that movie Worst Comes to Polly?
No, worst comes to worst, you just grab it and just crumble it
up. Oh, God.
No. We got no time for that.
It's your shit. It came from your body.
I'm not touching any of that. God.
Nope. It's your body. Where the hell do you think it came from?
I know where it came from.
I don't think anybody.
I'm crazy.
Quick. Where you go?
Crazy. You're the one grabbing feces. I'm crazy.
I've known janitors that does that, so it's not my first time seeing
this shit happen. God bless you all. Huh? God bless janitorial services for their service to this nation if they have to pick up turds from a toilet, because that's gross. Well,
some people have turds in the urinals.
Has anybody ever...
I might burn the school down at that point. I would never do that, but you know.
I've seen some crazy shit.
Literally and figuratively, huh?
Yeah.
What do you do if, like, it's you don't have the toiletries? Like, you go and it's not there.
No toilet paper, son?
Yeah.
Have you already gone, or did you see?
It's done. You're like, you're straight up, because that may or may not have happened to me before.
I just your sock.
No, I use the magazine. I may or may not have used their parents' magazine.
That was so bad.
What else am I going to do? It was a very long time ago. It was before Obama.
This was in the Bush years. But
yeah, I had no choice.
Was there no like napkins at the sink or anything? No tissues?
Nothing. I was so embarrassed.
Yeah, man, you could just use your boxers and just
wear clothing. I'm not losing.
And then you go commando right after that.
Yeah, honestly, that's a decent idea too.
No, I used the magazine. They said this is what you get, bad parents. You can't read. I don't even remember the magazine.
Probably Home and Country or whatever, or Town and Country.
Jesus.
Actually, Town and Country is a car, right?
I feel like it was like a female magazine, like a magazine towards women. Not saying that. I'm not. It just happened. That was the magazine.
Vogue.
No, I don't think it was that.
Did you at least go home right after?
Like maybe it was like mag. No, it was like a Newsday. Sleepover. I remember. It was a sleepover. I remember it was a sleepover.
You went to bed afterward, after throwing their magazine in the toilet.
There's no way you, like, cleaned it all, though.
I don't know, remember. It was so long ago, but I just remember that's what I did.
If I could take a shower, then maybe I'd do something like that.
But, you know? Yeah, like I said, I was, like, 9, 10. I don't even remember. Like, yeah, I was very young, but might have been very young. But that's what happened.
Might have been very young. I won't confirm or deny.
Last week.
Yeah, this is yesterday.
He's in the cold bathroom.
Jesus. No, my God. Jeez, that's a good one. But...
No, if it wasn't a friend's house or something like that, or like if it was a friend's house, but like you knew them really well, then maybe you could like take a shower after.
I guess so.
But what are you going to say? Like, hey, I just want to shower.
Yeah.
I mean, you could be honest.
I have a funny shower story for later. Yeah, that was quite a viral question. But moving on to other things and learning. We're all learning here tonight, right?
That's right.
Hear this, right? Now, we actually talked about the show very early in the year, and I'm really looking forward to it. Love on the Spectrum, right? Honestly, my favorite reality show of the year. No, I guess it's a documentary series. But for some reason, this one clip went re-viral, and it's about dating. And I think this is a great time. When we initially talked about this, we did not know Allison yet. So it's great to have her perspective on this great topic that we are about to discuss, right? As I am writing it right here. This is called Riz Research featuring Sado. That was his name, right? Subdue?
Sorry.
Remember from the first season, Subdue?
No.
He was the Indian
guy. I remember the Indian guy, but I didn't think that
his
name
was... Subdue. Subdue. Anyways, it doesn't matter. This is called Riz Research with Subdue. I'm going to just say that.
Subdue, but, that's fine, yeah.
But tell me if this is true or not. And I'm going to just play you the clip, and you can listen for those listening. Is it Subdo?
I don't know. Doesn't really matter.
Anyways, here's this lesson from Love on the Spectrum. Allison, Jose, Ryan, tell me if you agree or not. This was posted 4 days ago. 949,000 likes alone.
The show's popular.
I fucking love the show a lot. I still follow them. Abby, David, Subdue. Who else I like on that show? Danny.
Who was the one with the zoo? Went to the zoo.
Tanner.
Tanner, yeah.
Tanner, yep. You like that show, Allison?
Never seen it.
Really? Oh, I mean, it's a decent enough show.
It's a great show. It's on Netflix.
What? Yeah, it's decent enough.
I like it.
It is feel good. It is the feel good and feel good watch. Like, that is, I just love that show. It's genuinely well produced, too.
Does everyone find love?
No.
Not really.
It just shows that we're the problem. That's one thing. But anyways, I got to get to the actual clip and advice. So here is what we can learn from Subdue in terms of being on a date and figuring out who's going to pay for it.
Oh, I've seen this.
Oh, do you like to split the bill?
Is that to you?
Okay, quick. When you ask, do you want to split the bill, before we get Subdue's answer, what's the correct answer? First date.
Well, the correct answer is usually that, like, the guy should pay, but if someone asked me, I would split it.
Okay.
I would say that it needs to be established before the bill arrives.
It's already established. Whoever asked on a date is the one that should be paying.
No, I'm all right. Sorry, let me rephrase that. Yes, if you ask someone on a date, you could just pay and you don't have to worry about it. But if you wanted to split it, I'm saying, like, if that's where your head was at, then before you
you are not getting laid.
Regardless of that, before you like order, that needs to be like said. So, like, everybody knows, like, okay, we're splitting, or, oh, I'm paying for my part, or whatever. Like, and I am not saying if that will or won't affect your chances of anything else happening. I'm just saying, as a courtesy, you shouldn't let someone think that you're paying for an entire meal when you're only paying for half of it. You should tell them up front that you're only paying half of it.
Yeah, and then you will definitely know that this is not going to be getting laid or romantic.
That's possible.
I think that's uncomfortable. So, like, I think if, like, it was kind of in this situation where it comes on the spot, I would just say, okay, let's split it, because I wouldn't want to freaking deal with it.
Right, yeah, you'd just be like, fine. Yeah.
Yeah, but would you go... So no second date, correct?
No second... Unless we, like,
you say no what?
No second date.
No, oh, okay, yeah.
Second date, Matt. Get your head out of it.
I know, I was like, oh.
Yeah, you thought I said that too, right?
No. Unless, like Ryan said, it was before, like discussed before, like maybe there's financial issues or something, like that.
Or they take you to like a really expensive place. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like something that is very fancy for a first date.
I've maybe spent the bill on the first date before.
Yeah.
I mean, the Jesus dude Michael, Christ.
Here we go, Jose. Yeah, so. I love it.
But in all seriousness, yeah, if you say it before, I think it's better. You can't just spring that on somebody after they've eaten.
Because what are you going to do? Just walk out?
Yeah, exactly.
Some people, as we've seen. But yes, the idea is, I think we all could consensus this. Whoever asks on the date, but if the girl asks you, the guy pays anyway.
I don't know about
yeah,
that.
Pretty much. First date, guys pay.
I don't know about that.
And that's why it doesn't go to a second date.
I have dates for the second date.
If the girl asks.
If I'm interested in the girl, and I saw, and the girl I feel like is she's hot and I'm interested in a girl, I will not let her pay a damn dollar because I need to show dominance.
But there's different types of dominance.
There is, for guys, women's dominance is who's sexier. So every guy looks at a woman sexually, right? Let's be honest.
Well, then paying for a date has nothing to do with it.
Let me correction. I said what guys look for a woman is how hot they are. Women will look how financially set they are. Huge difference, isn't there?
I don't say this often, but I have absolutely no idea what you're talking about.
when a guy likes a girl,
I know a ridiculous amount of poor people who have managed to find people to sleep with them, to date them, to marry them, whatever. The number of children born into poverty in the wealthiest country in the world alone disproves the idea that you must be financially stable to secure a partner. There is nothing about the real world that makes it so you need financial security to have a partner. Now, if you have financial security, you might get your pick of your partners. You could walk around, decide who you like, be like, I've got money, so I don't need you, but I want you, and I don't want you. Like, I'm not saying money doesn't get you other things, but the idea that you must have money to compete is crazy.
I like this. Matt, let's go Matt. Matt, would you take a girl that's hot as fuck broke or take a girl that has money that's not that great looking?
The hot as fuck broke girl.
Thank you. All right, let's go. Allison.
Why? May I ask why?
Okay. No, we'll get to that. Allison now.
Pretty woman. That is literally this.
I got a decent dude, but he's broke as fuck. Nothing financially for him. Or I got another decent dude that is financially set and has a future. Who would you pick?
They're both decent dudes.
Both decent. Maybe, let's just say, the one that has no money has a heart of gold, but he's broke with no future. And you will be dependent on the paper from time to time. Or you have an average dude that has a financially set and everything. He knows what he wants. He got his head in the shoulder. He got a steady job and a steady income flowing with no problems. Who would you take?
Probably the dude with the heart of gold and who's broke.
And that's why you're single. Congratulations.
Wow, you didn't say what he wanted, so he freaking flipped the script.
No, I'm sorry.
I'm gonna let me get there.
I'm gonna give you the honest answer.
No, that's not your answer, so don't answer for me.
Okay, here you go. Tell me why.
Tell you why?
Yeah,
tell me why. About it.
Tell me why.
Tell me why.
Okay, so someone who has a heart of gold,
okay,
right, is usually willing to do things for other people.
Hey, right? I like that, but how? With no money.
But you don't have to have money to start
with no money.
You don't have to have money to start a career. You don't have to have money to have drive. You don't have to.
He needs to be financially dependent on you. So he's broke.
Most people in my age range, anyways, aren't financially stable to a certain extent. So it's like.
But that's not the question.
I would rather have someone who has a heart of gold and who's nice and at least like respects me and like.
Okay, but
I work hard and where I come from, rather than someone who's like, oh, just money. Like I'll just pay for this. Like it doesn't matter. Like things matter. Just because they don't matter.
Money matters. Actually, money matters.
Money matters money. Quite a bit. But it doesn't. Not the
whole. It's not definitive.
And that's why I said what I said about.
Not definitive.
Listen. Let's be honest. Because okay, go ahead.
I said I was just saying it wasn't definitive. It's not a definitive factor for me. Like,
and I said the same thing.
If I got my money straight and I got my money right, and my partner,
yes. But here's the problem. I love
what they got to do. Like,
you're right.
Okay, the money will come. It's fine.
Could you manage that long term though?
Yeah.
Because you should ask yourself if he's fine. If he can't even. Has no goals, no nothing. Nothing depend. He's depending on you.
You did not say.
Yeah, but you're creating.
You just said
a false dichotomy.
Was broke.
If he's
creating a false dichotomy.
If he's broke and he's coming to you and wants to date you. He thinks he's got a
There's
sugar mama.
There's a difference between someone that respects me and has a heart of gold and respects the money I make and wants, like, might need something once
well,
in a while.
Who said
that?
Wait. I never said the guy that's fantasy set is just doesn't treat you right. Or did I just
he
said
he's
the guy
average. Is, and most average guys okay. nowadays don't do it for me. Whether they have money or not. Most of them that have money, I end up probably making more money than them. And then I end up paying for stuff anyways because either I'm too nice or they're just.
And it never works out at the end, correct?
But this is crazy. My wife makes more than me.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. I know there's nothing wrong with that.
But there's a difference to me of, like, if you're a leech or if you're someone who...
Well, right. Like, Jose is creating a scenario it. Where the person who makes less money is also lazy and therefore making less money. The
if
reality...
I'm at your age, you know, the reality is, if I'm at your age bracket and I ain't have no job, no nothing, then what am I?
I mean, you could be unemployed. Okay. You know what I mean? Like, you could have lost your job. Like, there's tons of reasons you could be dating without money at the moment.
So from my understanding now of the situation is they've never had a job. They're broke. They just don't want to work hard, but they have a heart of gold. Is that what
so they're a nice deadbeat, essentially.
Nice deadbeat.
That's different.
Yeah, amazing deadbeat.
That's different. Then I would pick the guy who's average, which doesn't work out in my favor anyway, so I might as well date the broke motherfucker. And a guy who has money.
Yeah, I mean, yes. If you're saying this person has no prospects for a future, or an average guy with a job, then obviously average guy with the job is going to do better than man with no future. I'm just saying that that's a crazy specific scenario that ignores like a lot of other very plausible scenarios.
You make it sound like you're going to take the guy at heart of gold working at McDonald's or a business.
He worked at McDonald's. He has a job.
If you work for McDonald's and he wants to do something else, then what's the problem?
What? What can give me fries? Is that funny? What the hell?
I like fries. Fries are good.
Buddy. You work at McDonald's, but maybe you want to freaking, like, I don't know, own a food truck
they
someday.
They actually
you're working
have
the,
very
you know
good
I mean?
Upward
like,
mobility movement at McDonald's.
You want to know the funny thing is, y'all people trying to defend each other. The point is, the story is, is at the end of the day, women look for stability in a man. You're not getting that if I'm not can't afford to pay for a fucking movie, period. I don't care what y'all say. At the end of the day, a woman wants somebody with freaking stability.
Yeah, but stability period. Doesn't
that's
have to
the
be
difference,
financial.
But that's exactly, that's my point.
Has to be emotional
if you're
stability.
Not working, if you're working at McDonald's and you feel like that's the best you can do, it's an issue. If I feel like I have to go to a woman and tell her, listen, I'll pay half, even though I'm the one that asked you on a date, that's a problem. Period.
Let's see what the folks on Love on the Spectrum think about this, Matt. Because we've actually completely forgotten about the clip of this.
Did you hear the whole thing? But yes, I do have that for you. So I'll just quickly play it again. And what did we learn from Sabode? Is Sabode, by the way.
Yeah, Sabode, okay. About it.
All right, so Bode, what do you think?
Oh, do you like to split the bill?
Is that to you?
I will pay for it.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much. That's so nice of you.
Yeah.
Moral of the story, when she says, it's up to you, that means you pay for it.
Yeah, I'll say, even he picked up on that, right? He was like, oh, there's a right answer.
Now, Jose, do you agree with that?
Yeah, Jose said that.
Yeah, that's my thing. Guy's gonna pay. Period.
All right. All
he
right.
ain't stupid. If he's trying to, the boy's trying to get a girlfriend. You ain't doing that.
We support you, Sabode. We support you, OD. And I have learned as well. And yeah, good stuff. Why don't we have a quick nostalgia moment for a second while I quickly set up the next clip? Who remembers when they went to school and the TV was rolled out and they had that mm-hmm. static sound and this came on during science class? Between that and the zoo books, that's how you knew you were in elementary school.
I didn't remember the vocalizations. Those sounded very modern, to be honest with you. Is that is like a brat? I was the only one who heard that, or no?
No, I didn't hear that.
I did.
Oh, man.
Seriously, tonight, later, folks, listen to that. Find it, listen to it. It's there. It's the first time I've heard it, too, but anyway. No, yeah, I love those, like, those days, because you just have to sit back, watch. You wouldn't really have to do anything. Still learn, though, because they're educational.
Who remembers the just those days in class? Remember those days late in the day? Whether it was in elementary, middle, or high school, where you just spent the class just chilling and talking about life? I guess doing the tweet cap, essentially.
Do you remember, oh, God, what is her name? Science, chemistry. We had the same teacher.
Dr. Monroe,
that's right. If we had Dr. Monroe's class at the end of the day, though, everybody went to like the back where the experiment was and did nothing and just talked. And
yeah, you
that
could
was like
her,
the only time.
You could trick her to talk the whole class instead of teaching a lesson.
Yeah.
Her and it was whenever it was beavers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, that's anyway. Yeah, you could literally. Literally, if it's the end of the day, we would all like work together to ensure that we never did anything but just talk in class. We didn't learn a thing. We didn't do a single assignment on like a Friday end of the day if we had chemistry. And now I know very little about chemistry. So there we go.
Is that what happened? Do you remember those videos in Wisconsin, or did you not have TVs, Allison, in Wisconsin?
Yeah, what's a TV?
Oh, God.
It's like bowling. What's bowling?
What's bowling?
Jose, were you even in class when these videos were played?
No, it was not. I don't know what the fuck none of that shit is.
Jose graduated from videos.
What grade did you graduate elementary school?
What grade? The last year of elementary school would be 2005. No, 2005? 2006.
2005.
I was already out of high school.
But you didn't have those videos. I think those videos go back as far as the 90s, I saw. I actually researched.
I graduated elementary school in 95. That shit was not
I was born in 95.
I was born in 96.
Yeah, well, I was in middle school.
Oh, see?
Allison, quick question before we move to the next one. I won't ask if you have a TV. I know that you do. Do you know what the Runza is? Is that a Wisconsin thing too?
What's
or no?
Runza?
It's apparently a RZA. Nebraska thing. Runza? It's like a sandwich?
Oh, no.
Or a restaurant? Okay, I was just curious. I didn't know how far it stretched. I know it's Nebraska. I wanted to know if it came all the way to Wisconsin or not.
Got Culver's.
Culver's? I knew Culver's. Yeah, I know. And, hey, I'm doing well. I know a lot about it. I had the Piggly Wiggly on standby for today. So
I texted
my mom
about that shirt, and she goes, "I forgot we even had that." And I was like, "I know."
I'll have more. I'll find more. Don't you worry.
I'm gonna find the RZA.
The Runza.
All right, last but
the RZA.
I used to be so embarrassed of that shirt too. Like if I would go out in public and there'd be like cute boys, I'm like, "Dang, I have like a pig's ass literally on my back."
Oh Jesus. Anyways,
I think there's a Piggly Wiggly joke in there somewhere. But...
Somewhere.
Two things, or last three things. Number one, I'm just playing this hilarious dude. M.E.M_Rob, Meme Rob, Robert Morris.
Meme Rob.
Which I guess is the name of a college too. But Robert Morris, look at this funny ass dude.
I saw the news that Adrian Peterson went broke. And my first thought was, oh man, these huge contracts should come with some kind of financial literacy stipulation. But my second thought is, who is selling these niggas exotic animals? Every time one of us go broke, they find elephants and giraffes and shit in the backyard. Who told you that was a good idea, nigga? You got so much money. You can go to the zoo every day. What is a tiger gonna do at your house? Why can't you just have a dog, nigga? It's like y'all watch Scarface and never make it all the way to the end. That was a white dude pretending to be Hispanic. What do you think they gonna do with a real nigga? And to Mr. Peterson directly, how do you have so much child support? You had how many surgeries during your career? They could have threw in a vasectomy for free. My dog, you could have bought a Plan B, a condom, and a monastery for every carnal thought you ever had, and it still wouldn't add up to the $12 million you owe. Your nickname was AD all day. You should have signed with Adidas out of Oklahoma. Your slogan could have been all day I dream about saving. But no, apparently all day you dreamt about nutting in randoms and buying a monkey.
I have a feeling we're going to see this guy again and again and again. Meme Rob going in on Adrian Peterson of all people.
I mean, so one, didn't he was the one with his kid, right?
Yeah, he did get in trouble with child abuse.
Yeah. So I don't feel that bad that he's broke now. I feel bad for the kid because not getting his child support, apparently. But I don't feel bad that he's broke now after he beat his kid. But also, that does seem to be the case. And it's just all celebrities, honestly. Whenever they go broke, there's the most ridiculous nonsense that you find. Like, they'll you know what I mean? Like, and it's all celebrities, too. Musicians and actors. Like, if you go broke as a celebrity, I think it puts into very clear, like, terms how ridiculous being a celebrity, like, truly is. Because, like, a broke person having a tiger is just sad and kind of weird. It's only okay if you're also a multimillionaire. You know what I mean? Like if Elon went broke, but he owned, like, a spaceship, that's weird. Be like, you're broke. Why do you own a spaceship? It only works because he's a billionaire. Like, there are certain things that only rich people can have. That's kind of basically my point, is that, and I'm not just saying they're the only ones who can afford it. I mean, like, even if you inherited it, if you're not rich, it just feels weird that you have it, you know?
Yeah, I don't get it either. We saw in Tiger King how weird they are, the exotic animals, if anything.
None of those people were rich. None of those people were
like
rich.
Shaq hanging out with them. Damn, Shaq. Logan Paul. Well, that's not surprising.
That one doesn't surprise me.
Beyonce and you know what's going on there. But anyways. Nothing
is going on there. I will not let that slide in. I will not let that slide in.
I don't know. You see. But anyways.
No, I do know.
We'll see with the evidence. We can always refer to the super cool lawyer who will make his PCP debut sooner or later, featuring him in the clip. But I'm just fucking around. But yeah, so funny ass dude. So now we're gonna end this with two motivational moments, right? Two big motivational moments. First, we have Hustle and Flow, which is a movie I finally saw for the first time this past weekend, right? Very good movie. Very good movie. I'd give it a 4 out of 5 in my special ranking. Follow me on Letterboxd at mbrown3212. And it also introduced Whoop That Trick for the WWE fans out there. Mm-hmm. I had no idea that's where that term actually came from. You knew about that, Jose?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Pretty cool, pretty cool. But here is this. After watching this, this actor has been around my whole life. And he's been in a lot of stuff. And I always thought, man, he's cool. He's a good actor. But then I realized, like, wow. Thinking back and now thinking about the stuff he does on the sitcom he's still on now, and he's a generational talent, really. And this actor, I know I'm not talking about Terrence Howard, but Anthony Anderson. I was like, wow, this guy is very talented, and it sucks I didn't realize till now. And he's only been in movies forever, and he could actually like act. And I'll show you a scene shortly. But what you about to say, Ryan?
As is Terrence Howard, he's very good too. I just wanted to.
True, just bad decisions and a nut job. left Marvel. But he said, fuck this. leaving the MCU and then Don Cheadle took his role as
Iron Patriot.
As no,
Iron Patriot's the name of the superhero that they play, but it's like Rhodey or whatever, or Rhodey or something, Commander Rhodey or Sergeant
But Rhodey, War Machine. Yeah. Anyways, I'm rambling on, but look at this great ass scene from the great Anthony Anderson.
She a good woman.
Wait, hold up. And by the way, this is called me and bro in our 30s just talking about life shit.
Life, man, she a good woman. She feeds me. She get freaky on my birthday.
What she do?
None of your business. Sometimes I feel, man, like I talked such a good game when we was young, man, about my own studio and my own label. And shit, DJ, now I'm just paying rent, man. This shit right here ain't gotta work. Gotta work, man, because it ain't over for me.
That's literally me every single fucking night making this podcast. I swear to God, I say the same exact stuff. May or may not be participating in that thing they were doing while saying that. I don't know. That just hit, right?
I mean, yeah, it's deep.
Vets goes deep.
But hey, it ain't over for me. That's I think the key takeaway, right? You got to remember that part. It's never over unless you let it be over.
That's what a fuck is.
And that's all on you.
And his woman paid for him, so
I bet you that's what happened.
And you know what?
Wasn't it?
Let's end it with John Cena with literally the most motivational viral moment of the year. Let him speak for himself. This is truly as good as it gets. John Cena on the Kai Cenat live stream.
Hey, everybody out there. Wow, this has been fun. And here we are sharing a moment together. Hopefully a moment of motivation, purpose, growth. I guess if I would have to bestow some advice, take it if you want it. If not, it's just advice. I would say never give up. And that widens out to whatever lens you want to put it in. I think as long as we are breathing, we have a chance, we are all eventually going to get to the finish line. So, I don't know, if you just attack every day with persistence and effort and, you know, follow your excitement and enthusiasm and never give up, especially through those hard times, because I'm not going to act like it's all roses and candy canes. There'll be a bunch of hard times. Just do your best, try to do the best you can, and never give up.
Let me just end the show like that, huh?
I mean, yeah, that's actually, I'll just say, obviously I like that. Anyone, and I don't typically tell people to watch Kai Cenat, but that entire episode is that, by the way. Like, that's just the end of a much longer stream. That entire stream with John Cena is little nuggets like that for the most part. There's a couple other really good ones. So next time you're like, let me listen to Jordan Peterson, just don't. I'm telling you to go listen to Kai Cenat. We can get behind that, right? Right? It's a happy middle ground between, you know, like being a good person and listening to Andrew Tate. Just listen to John Cena on Kai Cenat. Everyone wins. Trust me.
Jose, Allison, give us something.
What? You cut out. I'm so sorry.
No, give us something after that. Just give us something.
What's your reaction?
Didn't you hear me? I said he got really hot.
John Cena.
Oh.
I didn't know if y'all heard me.
I didn't hear that.
I mean,
yeah,
okay.
He got hot.
Okay, that's what I said.
Never give up. You'll always become hot.
I don't know that that's what he said. But...
got it.
Jose. Still there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah.
The shit. He a fucking big ass motherfucker. Fucking
what? That's what you had to say.
Oh. Greatest champion in WWE history. You're calling me a what now?
Yes, say it again, Ryan.
Greatest champion.
He said WWE Hulk history. Hogan.
And he treats women like shit. So same
John
shit.
John Cena. No, he doesn't.
He cheated on his wife.
And?
Yeah, he told me never give up. He told me never give up.
Cheater? Oh.
No, yeah, he told me never give up.
Of course I think he's hot. He's a cheater.
Let's ask Mickey James how she doing.
Mickey James?
Yeah, when John Cena moved her.
He beat a woman.
Got fired.
No.
John Cena didn't get fired.
John Cena got it fired. You didn't know that?
I heard that, but I just don't believe it.
Everybody knows that happened.
All right. Well, no, everybody thinks they know that happened.
Everybody knows she got him switched brands middle story, and they had a storyline together, cut out the blue, get switched brands, get made fun of, be calling a fat pig, and then gets released. That's facts. Who's he boy with?
Anybody.
Vince McMahon.
Okay. I think anybody who knows.
Everybody knows.
Anyone who has seen a Vince McMahon documentary knows without a doubt that Vince McMahon did not need anyone's help in belittling the female talent on his roster.
Oh,
he did not
need
John Cena's permission to come up with Piggy James. I promise you, he had that thought all on his lonesome.
Let's get this right, Ryan. If you're my boy and you wanted me and you were cheating on a woman and I was the owner of the company and you wanted me to move her, I'll move her because you're my boy, which they're boys. Now, but you know my sick mind is to belittle motherfuckers. John, do you think John Cena is going to go, yo, Vince, stop?
So he has to now step in and be like, don't be a freak about it?
No, don't be. I'm this amazing John Cena. I do this. Don't give up. Blah, blah, blah. But you see that shit to a person you were fucking with. Knowing what you're going to belittle. You could have said something because you were John. You're Vince McMahon's boy. To this day, by the way, John Cena won't say not one thing bad about Vince.
He won't say anything bad about Vince. It's quite upsetting. But that doesn't change what I said.
But of course you're going to think that. But his whole mantra is that whole bullshit. Everybody knows he's a dick in real life.
I'm not saying John Cena is an actual saint. I'm saying that as far as advice goes...
He has the most make-a-wish. This was not supposed to be this long.
I'm saying as far as good advice for young men goes,
I get for saying
you can listen to people like John Cena, or you can listen to people like Andrew Tate.
You know what?
You are so right, Ryan.
And if you're asking me if cheating one time... and having a coworker that you've ended a relationship with go on to a different brand, if that's what you're asking me to say, then I simply won't say it because it's not true. There's two people talking to young men right now. One of them is a regular dude who's trying to give good advice. The other one is a ghoul. I want kids to listen to the regular dude who's going to talk to them about how to be a good person because he's a real person. He's lived real life. I do not want him listening to the internet ghoul who's a fiction of every young boy's wet dream. That's what I don't want them to listen to. So John Cena gets the A+ from me, and I don't care if he had Mickey James get moved to another show.
I'd take Andrew Tate all day long.
Well, listen, I know you would because I've heard you speak before, but you're 40 in a lost cause. I want young people to not be like Andrew Tate. So that's why I want them to listen to John Cena. You see what I'm saying? It's different. You're 40 years old. You're a grown man.
I just said he was hot. I didn't know this was going to get a whole...
John Cena told me hustle, loyalty, respect.
Listen, you're a grown man, Jose. I want you to do what makes you happy. But for the kids out here...
Still do what makes you happy.
No, yes, but I want them to have positive role models. And if the two options are Andrew Tate or John Cena, and they basically are, then I want them to pick John Cena every time, realize, without question.
You realize that when after the age of 16, John Cena is a Fruit Loop wearing motherfucking has been. And then Andrew Tate looks real clean when you get to the 20-year-olds. Oh, that's why everybody goes to Andrew Tate.
It's facts. It's not facts.
Nobody in their 20-year-olds is going to be like, hey, I'm a John Cena. Let me get my purple shirt.
I don't need them to be 20. I need them when they're 15.
Yeah, but they switch when they get to 16. They realize,
no, they don't. If they have good role models to start with, then they never feel the need. I'm speaking from experience. I never felt the need to turn full on hate women incel because I had good role models when I was younger. And I'm saying that there's not enough of them and we need more of them when they're younger. If you get 20 and you decide that fake ass shit that you see with the fake Lamborghinis and the fake underage, not the fake, actually the girls are underage, but that's beside the point. If that's what you want to do, if that's who you want to be, then whatever. You're 20 years old, you're 21 years old, you're a full adult. If you want to be that way as a full adult, then that is your prerogative. But I think that when kids are raised in a way that doesn't glorify those things by listening to that stuff when they're 14, 15, 16 years old, by listening to the people like John Cena, they avoid falling into those traps. And basically I'm telling you that from personal experience of not falling into those traps and from every ounce of research that we've seen that younger and younger kids are listening to that toxic nonsense. So if you're going to listen to toxic nonsense or you're going to listen to John Cena, then I don't give a crap that he cheated on somebody. I really don't. Most of the people that I know have cheated on somebody. Half of the people, more, maybe even more than half of the people on this podcast right now have cheated on somebody. So, and I still talk to all of them. I don't need my morals to be so squeaky clean. Pope Ryan is absolutely willing to speak to anybody about anything because people are people. They make mistakes. But good advice is good advice. And that's why I want people to listen to this episode and not to what's going on elsewhere.
Real talk. Yeah.
This is how we're going to end tonight's show. With a goodbye song. If you know it, you know it. If you don't, you don't.
You ready to sing goodbye?
Copyright.
Okay. I don't care. Because that could just get removed off at the end, anyways.
We've got the pumpkin.
So long, farewell to you, my friends. Goodbye for now. Until we meet again.
How old were you? Were you
farewell to you, my friends.
No.
No, okay. This was when me and Matt were kids. That's why I figured you're a little old for this.
Who is this?
It's in the box.
In the box.
And now it's time to
I was already fucking by the time this thing came out.
To you, my friends. Goodbye for now. Until we meet again. Goodbye.
This is me and Big Mark, by the way.
Until we meet again.
That'll be me
Thank
and
you
Big
so
Mark.
So much, everybody, for a great productive conversation. We'll see you back here on the TweetCast, specifically on Tuesday. We will be on top of all of that, we have our NLCS Game 4 reaction and Game 3 of the ALCS reaction available right now. And we'll have our picks available on Friday for week six of the NFL. No, sorry.
Seven.
Week seven of the NFL, week 8 of college football. And follow us all week and weekend as we continue to cover these playoffs and also recap our sports, the NFL. And we got NBA next week, too. And we got spooky season. And we got it all. But seriously, good stuff, everybody. I hope you had as much fun as I did. Thank you, Ryan, Allison, and Jose. Have a wonderful night, everybody. See you soon.
Have a good night.